welcome to the Cedar Arrows Podcast. My name is Rebecca. I am a Christian, a wife, a mom of six, a homeschooler, a homesteader, a knitter, a reader, and this channel is just where I like to talk about all of those things. It will mostly be knitting, but you just never know what else you might find here. I am thrilled that you are here with me today, and I hope that you will find something that you enjoy. You can find me on Instagram and Ravelry as happyhomemaker05, and I am just thrilled that you've joined me here today. Today is Friday, January 19th. It has been almost an extra week, almost 3 weeks, since I recorded last. I had planned on recording last Friday or Saturday, and then I just honestly got into a time crunch and needed to focus on my daughter's birthday socks. So I decided Friday morning, this is just what I'm going to have to do today so that they could be done in time. And I knew that you would all still be here when I got around to it. This is, you know, this is a fun thing, but I have seven other people in this household with me. And so sometimes I just have to rearrange things a little bit. Thank you for being here. Thank you for your patience. And thank you also just for letting me know that you're still going to be around and looking forward to the next one. In the last 3 weeks since I recorded last, there's been several things going on. Right after I recorded last, my younger brother and his children came from Missouri to visit for a little while. We had a wonderful time with them. They stayed with my parents, who live about 20 minutes from us, and my kids were there with them more than they were home that week, soaking in all that cousin time they could get. It was wonderful. We had our family Christmas, which was just the right amount of loud and chaotic and so much fun. We took family pictures with, my parents, siblings, and grandparents. It was the first time in a while that we'd been able to get everyone together and do that. So I'm very glad we did that. We just had a wonderful time, and I'm very, very thankful that we had that time together. This week has been a little more bumpy. We had a little bit of a scare with my grandmother on Sunday. We were afraid she might have had a stroke. That was ruled out pretty quickly, thankfully, but she was in the hospital for a few days. So, you know, there was a lot of uncertainty and just not sure what was going on or what was going to happen, but she is doing much better. She came home yesterday, and then we were able to all have a very low-key birthday celebration for her last night. She turned 80 right after Christmas, and we had had to delay her birthday party a couple of times. So it was nice, even though it was very low key and, you know, very, very simple since she was just coming home from the hospital, it was still good to be able to celebrate her for a little while. excuse me, I feel like I always have a frog in my throat, so I've got tea and water here and we're just going to do the best we can. there are also six children here in the house doing schoolwork, so you might hear them, here and there. It's just life here. It's always pretty loud around here. And then I also have the two dogs in the room with me, but the UPS man has already come, and so I shouldn't have to pause for that anyway. They lose their minds every time as if, you know, we're being invaded. It's ridiculous. But anyway, I guess let's go ahead and start talking about the knitting. First off, I'm wearing a hat that I made, and I don't really feel like taking it off, so I'll just share a picture so you can see it better. But this is the Hot Springs Beanie by Kristie of Little Comforts. I knit this a few years ago. I'm not really sure. I don't remember when I made this one, but I have knit this pattern twice. I love it. It's just a really nice lace pattern, knit in DK weight yarn, so it knits up quickly and it's squishy and it's just great. This yarn is Knit Picks Gloss DK in the Pine colorway. I've mentioned before how much I love this color. I have several things knit in this yarn. It is one of my very favorites. And then I also have it knit in a a cashmere blend that I dyed several years ago. And if I can find a picture, I'll share that here too. But it's a lovely pattern. Kristie has a couple of other, a few patterns that are all really nice. And I think this is the only one of hers that I have knit, but I own a couple of others. And looking back over her shop to get ready for my, with my show notes, made me want to knit some more of her patterns. So definitely check her out. So moving into finished objects, my first finished object for this year is has already been gifted. And so I don't have it to show, but I will share some pictures of it as well. I knit this pair of crisp apple strudel mittens for a friend of mine at church. I had been thinking literally for weeks and weeks and weeks, trying to think of something really special that I could give this friend. She's just a wonderful person, and I've made some things for her in the past, and we don't always exchange Christmas gifts specifically, but she is one of those people that we frequently do, just, you know, if I find something for her or she finds something that makes her think of me, we do exchange gifts from time to time. And I had just wanted to do something really nice for her and could not think of anything. I was so busy with my family's Christmas and all that knitting that I was doing for that, that I just, my brain was coming up blank. So it wasn't until, I think, New Year's Eve that I pulled out my pair of these mittens, and I was just kind of admiring the cabling. I love this pattern. And I said, I really want to knit this again. I need to figure out somebody to knit this for. And then it was a little while after that. Like, it, you would think that that would be kind of immediate, but it took me a while even then to have that brainwave. I could knit these for Beth. So I went home and dug through my stash and found some Quince and Co. chickadee in the pea coat colorway. A nice navy blue. She loves blue like I do, so I knew that that would work well for her. And so I knit these up that week and gave them to her the next Sunday. So I don't have them to show, like I said, but they are just lovely. The again, another DK weight project. I think technically chickadee is sport. I'm not sure. Anyway, I did move up. I think I moved up a needle size, because this yarn was a little bit thinner than what I had made this same pattern with before. And I didn't write any of that down because, you know, that would require thinking ahead and thinking of the right things, and that didn't happen. But anyway, I knit these on a larger size needle, and I just love the way they turned out. Whatever size needle the pattern calls for, I did the next size up. Anyway, these took just under 50 grams of Quince & Co. chickadee, which was nice. I had two skeins and thought I would probably need to break into that second one, but I didn't. And so I know now that I can make another pair if I want to from that same, that other ball of yarn. So again, these are the Crisp Apple Strudel Mittens. They're by Katy Carroll of Katinka Designs. And they were part of a collaboration a few years ago with A Little Skein in the Big Wool. This pattern was inspired by The Sound of Music, the crisp apple strudel from the song, a few of my favorite things. So it specifically is designed to kind of mimic that look of a braided strudel, which pastry strudel, which I think is so neat. So I love this pattern, love making cabled things. All I've wanted to knit are mittens. And I'm actually planning another pair of this same pattern pretty soon for another gift. But I just absolutely loved knitting this up. And that was kind of all I wanted to do for those few days. And I gave them to her after I finished them, and they fit her perfectly. And she is a person who always has cold hands, so she was very excited. And it's always so nice when your gifts are so well received. She absolutely loved them. So that was a complete joy to knit, and I will be knitting more of this pattern. It is just lovely. Let me see. My next finished object is another gift. I knit a second Knubbelchen doll I think this is just the sweetest. Isn't he pretty? This is for some dear friends of ours who just had their second baby. I actually got some, I received the birth announcement yesterday with some sweet pictures of him. I need to get this in the mail to him. And we're so excited about that sweet little baby. So every baby is knit worthy. I love to knit for little tiny new people. And I just think this is the sweetest pattern. So after I had knit the first one, I thought that that would be perfect for this baby as well. So this yarn is from Dup Duck Wool. It's just some leftovers from a giveaway that I won several years ago. And I just love this. I knit this according to pattern. I think I should probably remember to take note of this next time. I think I knit this on size 2 needles, whatever the pattern said, I'm pretty sure is what I did. It's sock yarn, and I knit my socks with size 2 needles, and so I'm pretty sure that was what I went with. And I knit it according to pattern, except that for the appendages, I knit 10 extra rows. I borrowed that tip from Emily of Salt City Knits. She had talked about doing that to make it easier to tie these knots. And so I haven't tried it the other way, but for both of these that I've made, I went ahead and did that. Just once you're decreased down to the smallest number of stitches, instead of binding off, I knit 10 extra rows and then bound off so that it made it a little easier to tie these knots. But I wish I had been knitting when I had babies. I would have knit all the things. I was crocheting. I crocheted them a lot of toys, but I wish I had learned to knit earlier. Anyway, I think this is precious. My daughters are all telling me that when they have babies, they will need some of these, and so that's exciting. We're still several years away from that yet. So that's my second finished object. Next, I have this teeny little thing that I mentioned last time. This is the Bluebird of Happiness pattern by Sarah Elizabeth Kellner on Ravelry. I'm pretty sure it's a free pattern. And I knit this with Yarnbrary sock yarn in the Maple Sugar Party colorway. She sold, it's a Little House on the Prairie inspired colorway that she sold several years ago. And she's not dyeing yarn anymore. I talked about this a little last time. I had intended to knit myself a pair of socks with this sock set. It was this lovely variegated pink and cream colored yarn with, I think, kind of a goldish mini skein. And I had intended to knit myself some socks. But I had a friend who had a baby last year, and I was going through my stash to try to find some yarn to make gifts for her and her big sister, and the baby and her big sister. And my eyes landed on that yarn, and I thought that would be perfect for matching hats, and it did make the cutest little hats. So I did that, and then I've used like little bits of it for other little gifts. The Knubbelchen doll that I showed last time, and a couple of other things, some newborn socks. So then I realized as I was finishing up that doll that I didn't have anything that I had knit for myself in this yarn, and I can't get more of it, and so it's, you know, kind of precious. And so I thought, well, I've always intended to make a Bluebird of Happiness, and I could use my leftovers for that. So this just sits now in my little yarn bowl on my bookshelf in here, and it's just so cute. And I also have a square in my memory blanket of from that same yarn, so that makes me feel a little bit better about the fact that I am almost entirely out of that beautiful skein. I think I've mentioned Yarnbrary in probably all of my episodes. I loved her yarn, and I'm enjoying using up every little bit of the scraps that I have. So my next finished object is another whip from, or a whip from last time. This is the Xenia cowl by Hillary Smith Callis. that pattern has a slip stitch texture detail that I, instead of doing that, I omitted that and added a garter eyelet detail. I like that, the way the pattern is originally written. I've knit it that way before, but I also just like the simplicity of all this stockinette with the little eyelets scattered throughout. I really, really just love stockinette fabric, and I love the way it kind of lets the yarn do the talking. And so I have knit this both as written and then this modification several different times. So this is knit from Paper Crane Yarns in the Roller Rink colorway. Paper Crane Yarns is a store a little over an hour from me in Calera, Alabama, and she has a yarn line of her own hand-dyed yarns as well. And I love her yarns. I love knitting with her yarns, so I thought that was a lot of fun, and I'm excited to have it done, and it blocked out beautifully, so I'm really excited about that one. And I don't guess I have too much to say about it because I talked about it last time, but I think it just turned out so nicely. And then I guess, well, no, I still have two more. One other whip that I had started, or this is a finished object that was a whip last time. I'm getting tongue-tied. I still have some ends to weave in. It just finished drying not that long ago. I just blocked it yesterday. But I have finished my little leftovers cowl. Isn't it fun? I just love these colors. It is so bright and springy and colorful. And it's funny because these are not typically, bright is not what I typically will go toward, but I think it's so pretty. And I've talked about this yarn, gushed about this yarn. You've heard me talk about it. You've seen my Instagram posts. But this is knit with my leftovers from the Candy Shop Yarns 2023 Advent Calendar. Deborah sent me that Advent Calendar as a gift, and you know I have enjoyed it so much. And so I knit the habitation throw, which is behind me on my chair, and then used leftovers for this beautiful cowl. And I have enough leftover of almost all the colors, if not all of them, that I will also be putting squares in my Cozy Memories blanket. The one I'm not sure about is this yellow, the second to last color, because it just uses, you know, the bottom colors use a lot more than these at the top. And so I'm not sure if I have enough. I haven't weighed that ball yet. But anyway, I have enough of almost every color to also put them in my memory blanket, and that will use up pretty much every last bit of these yarns, which has been really fun. When I started on this cowl, I know I was already working on it, and I've said some of this before. I just keep looking at it. When I started this cowl, I had kept, as I opened the advent calendar, I would use 10 grams of the mini skein, and then I would put what was left back in its little package and kept it in this tote bag on my closet door here. And so that way they were all in order and I could use them in the same order again. And so then as I started back over at day one, I was just as excited to start a second time as I had been the first time. And I'd seen them all. They weren't a surprise anymore, obviously, but it was still just so fun to pull each new colorway out of its little package. I have just gotten so many hours of enjoyment out of that yarn, and I am excited to wear this cowl. And I'm loving having this throw blanket to put over my legs in the morning and that kind of thing. I just love it. So that has been a lot of fun, and you know, it's given me a month and a half of constant knitting this advent calendar has. So such a nice gift. My last finished object for this time is this pair of socks for my daughter. And they are not the socks that I had in progress last time. This cowl, Little Leftovers Cowl by Tellybean Knits. You've probably seen this pattern before. You've probably heard of it, but I wanted to make sure I mentioned that. It is designed specifically to knit with leftovers from an advent calendar. It is knit in 25 sections, alternating different texture patterns. There's eyelets, there's kind of a twisty cable thing, there's slip stitches. So you alternate different fun texture sections with just plain garter sections. And like I said, there are 25 sections. So I have all 24 of the mini skeins and then also a little bit from the full skein in this cowl. And each section is only 6 rows long, so you know it is really designed to use up just little bits of yarn. I have knit this pattern before just using some of my scraps, and I didn't have as many scraps, and so I think I did, you know, two or three sections for each color that I used. So this is the second time I've knit this pattern, and I absolutely love it, and I'm sure I will knit it again. It is just, it's very potato chippy because of the short sections, and it's just so lovely, and it has such a nice drape. It's easy to wear. Cowls are one of my favorite things because they're just so easy. You just put it on and go. So I really, really am excited about that. Back to the socks. So these are not the socks that I showed you last time, and there's a fun story about that. But first, this main color yarn is the Tea Time colorway from Big Sky Yarn Co. The contrast color is Raspberry Cordial, also from Big Sky Yarn Co. They're both I think it's the Star Sock base. I think they are so nice together. This pattern is the Yarnbrary's Emily Clawson's Fizz socks pattern. So it's just a real fun, simple eyelet. Last time I showed you that I was working with a beautiful Rapunzel inspired sock set from Malia Made It. And I was really excited about giving her those socks. I had knit one sock a few years ago, and the pattern combined with the heel that I chose just did not work for my foot. I was using the heel toe do-si-do pattern by the Crazy Sock Lady, and because I was just enjoying the color striping and I didn't want to mess up the colors, I decided to do an afterthought heel, which I almost never do, and I think I'd only knit it once for myself, and it made a beautiful sock, but my ankles and arch just don't do well with the afterthought heel. My feet are too wide and my arch is really high, and it didn't work. But I did not want to pull out that sock because it was so pretty. And so it sat there because I was just so indecisive about it. And it dawned on me a few months ago that they would fit my daughter perfectly. She has the same length of foot as mine. It's almost the same width, and she just doesn't have as tall an arch. And so it would be perfect for her foot. And I even months ago had her try it on and confirmed that it was perfect for her foot. And I said, okay, well, you might get these someday and act surprised if you do. And she's like, okay. So I had for a long time, months, I had planned on finishing that pair and giving them to her for her birthday. And so I was excited last time I recorded because I already had one sock done. And so it was going to be real easy to whip up that second sock. And then just a few days later, she came to me and she said, hey, I was thinking, could you knit me some ankle socks for my birthday? And I just said, okay, maybe. I'll let you know. And then after she walked out of the room, I told my husband, I have a sock done already and it's not a shorty sock. So I had my moment to be sad, and then dug in my stash again and found these yarns, which are perfect for her. She's a very bright, bubbly person. She loves pink. These are very much also her thing. Also, she's very much into anything related to tea. And so with one of the colorways being called Tea Time and the other being an Anne of Green Gables reference, that was kind of perfect. So she was absolutely thrilled. We celebrated her birthday on Monday, and she did all the appropriate amount of squealing and was so excited about the socks. And the reason she wanted them to be short is because she has some ankle boots that she wears usually with her church clothes. And she really, really, really loves her hand-knit socks. And so she wanted hand-knit socks that she could wear with those boots. So, I mean, I can't complain about that, right? So that beautiful Rapunzel-inspired sock is still sitting, has not gotten any attention since the last time I recorded because I was working on these. And I've just not been in the mood for socks. After Christmas, I'm usually just not. I don't want to make socks in January or February. It's usually a while before I'm really in the mood again because I've knit so many socks. And other things like mittens and cowls and shawls are the thing I really prefer. So I kind of had to like I mentioned earlier, I kind of had to buckle down and make myself work on the socks to get them done for her birthday, but it's 100% worth it because she loves them so much. So I'm very glad that they're finished. I'm glad that she loves them. I'm glad that they turned out so cute, and I have turned my attention more to other things than socks. And it's funny because once I get into the groove, like I really did enjoy knitting the sock, but it was just not the thing that I was naturally picking up. There were other things that I wanted to knit on. And so this was more of a choice than just going with what I wanted to do in the moment, if that makes sense. So I guess I'll move into whips. Let me see. Well, the one I'm holding right now that I've been working on a little bit as I've been talking is just the beginning of the Simply Scrappy Cowl by Helen Stewart. This is just the first color I'm about to, as I've been sitting here talking, I've finished that first color, so I'll attach the second one in a little while. But this is another Advent pattern. I don't remember if this one's designed for leftovers or just for Advent in general. I'm not using an advent calendar with it, but it is a pretty customizable pattern. So I'm just going to be doing fewer colors because I have a 10 skein, mini skein set from Gem State Yarns. This was her November sock scrappy club. I don't remember what she calls it, but you know, it's one of those club purchases where you pre-order it and it's... you know the inspiration, but you don't know what the yarns exactly look like. So it's this beautiful set of kind of greens and browns and cranberry reds and cream color yarns. I have 10 gram minis. So I'm just gonna knit until I run out, and it'll be however long it is when I get done. But it's just a single loop cowl with some eyelets scattered throughout. I don't know how well you can see that. But anyway, so I just finished the first color and I'll attach the second color. I think I mentioned last time that I was going to work on this, and it's something that I have really been wanting to work on, but I have a lot of gift knitting still in January and February, and so this has just kind of been a back burner thing. But it is just total vanilla knitting, and so I love that. So this is a really good project for reading with the kids or, you know, taking on the go. So I'm excited and hoping I can spend more time on this pretty soon. My next, I'm just not good at random. Like, I know part of the fun is just to randomly reach into your bag and grab the thing, the next color, but I usually just don't do that very well. So I did kind of lay out the skeins and plan them out, and we'll see if I end up doing it that way or not. But what I think will be next is this pretty variegated red and white with some brown speckles. So I'm excited to see how that knits up. So again, this is the Simply Scrappy Cowl by Helen Stewart, and the yarns are from Gem State Yarns. Let's see, my next whip, this is the one that has been getting all of my attention the last little while. I'm loving this so much. This is a test knit for Emily Clawson of Salt City Knits. You may have seen this on her podcast. It's also on Instagram. I've been posting a lot of pictures of it. This is going to be called the Mill Hollow Scarf. It is still in the testing phase, and it is supposed to be released on February 1st, so not much longer. It takes one skein of sock yarn. I'm using Magpie Fibers Swanky Sock in the Evil Beaver colorway, which I think is just gorgeous. It's this rich brown. It begins at a point here. There's so much brown around me. I always feel like it's hard to show brown, but there's also a window behind the camera, so I can't see what you're seeing. So, oh boy. Anyway, it begins at a point, and then you increase as you go, and it comes out to, I'm at its widest point right now. So you increase gradually to its widest point, and then I'll decrease back to a tip, to a point at the end. This lace detail is absolutely lovely. I really can't see. I'm not good at this yet. This lace detail is so nice. It is almost mindless for me at this point. It's very easy to read where you are in the repeat. So I don't even, for the main lace section, I have not had to really refer to the pattern much since I got into a groove. You can just read where you are and know what to do next. And I love that. The pattern has several charts, which I love. I've talked before about that, about how I'm a lefty. And so it's really nice when I can look at a chart because I can just look from left to right, which is the opposite of how a righty would read the chart. And it makes the decreases what they're supposed to be. Anyway, I've talked about that before. It doesn't matter. But anyway, I really enjoy working from a chart. And there are several charts in this pattern that are just so easy to follow. I am testing it, and so far I haven't really had any feedback other than I love this pattern. She does such a great job with her patterns. It's so well done by the time it gets to the testers. So this is my first test knit ever, and I'm so excited to be involved in it. I'm just loving this pattern. I can't wait to see it blocked, but I'm also not in a hurry to finish it from the standpoint that I just am enjoying it so much. But this is my number one like main project right now. I do need to get it finished pretty soon so she can have some finished object photos by the time the pattern releases. But I will be knitting it again. I just love it. And I think I showed you this last time, but we're just going to look at it again because it's so cute. This bag is from Barley Pearls and features all of the characters from Little Women, which you probably already know is one of my favorite books. I just love this right here. Jo with her nose in a book. It's so sweet. So I got this from Barley Pearls on Etsy. It's beautifully made. I love it so much. And I found out about her shop from another podcast. I don't remember who, but I just love it. So check her shop out for sure. So that's my favorite whip right now. That's the thing I'm spending most of my time on. It's so lovely. And I know that all of you will love it. I can't wait for it to be released. What do I have next? Okay, well, I have a slight start on another pair of socks for another child. So I got my January birthday covered just barely, and the next one is a February birthday. I have just over a month, but this is my oldest son, the biggest feet in the house. And he likes a 10-inch leg. So I thought since I am not super in the mood for socks, I should just cast this on and get it started. And then it's just kind of living in my purse. So when we're out and about, this is what I can pull out and work on. And so maybe it won't feel like I have to be in a rush to get it done. So right now I have not even the full cuff done. But honestly, this is one of my favorite parts of knitting a sock. So I am more drawn to it when it's at this stage. This yarn is, the colorway name is just a number and I don't remember it and didn't write it down, but, it is Ultra Soxx, Lang Ultra Soxx is the yarn, and it's kind of a speckly heathered gray and blue, and I think he's going to just love this. While my oldest daughter likes the very bright, colorful things, my oldest son wants things to be pretty muted, so this is exactly his kind of thing. Fortunately, I also am drawn to like earthy muted colors, and so I don't mind so much knitting the darker socks for him. But he has, these are the biggest socks. He is to the point where his feet are bigger than my husband's. And so his are the ones that are the most time and yarn consuming of anybody in the household. So it's a good thing I don't mind the darker colors because these take a while. And this is in just a sweet farm homestead bag from Molly Klein Design. And of course I'm drawn to the farming fabrics. That's what we do. So that is really I have one more. This hasn't gotten much attention, but it is another thing that has been calling my name lately, and so I've just pulled it out to work on in the evenings the last few nights. This is my coziest memory blanket. I've shown you most of these squares before, and this is all a mess because I've got all these scrap balls here. So I haven't worked on this much since like October or November because of all the gift knitting, but I do love it so much, and I love that I can just pick it up and work for a little while, and then if I need to put it down, I can, and it just sits there and waits for me and doesn't judge me. And someday it will be a big, lovely blanket that I can actually cover up with. But I wanted to show this part so you can see I have this long stretch of squares over here, and then I've got this going on off the corner. When I started this blanket years ago, I had this idea that it would be cool if I could do kind of four central squares going in different directions, you know, where the decreases are traveling in a different direction, and work off of that. That's not how the pattern is written. It's written just in strips. And at the time, I was a new enough knitter that I didn't know how I would make the four central squares work. And so I just never spent the time to really try to figure it out. But it has been kind of in the back of my mind as I've pulled this back out. I talked about this a few episodes ago. I pulled this back out after years of sitting in a closet, and I have put a lot more into it since then. But this had stayed in the back of my mind. This was my original square. And then the crazy sock lady, Kay, always does her Cozy Memories blankets this way, where she starts with four central squares and then builds off of that. And one day I thought, I know I could do that. I just have to take the time to figure out exactly where to pick up and what to cast on and how to orient it, but it can't be that hard. And so I like zoomed in on one of her Instagram pictures and really looked at it and thought about it for a minute, and it isn't that hard. I just had to actually, you know, spend some energy on it for a few minutes. But I was kind of ridiculously proud of myself when I figured out how to do that. And so I added this one, I think, first. And then I'm working on this one now. And so that is my plan, is to build off of these other three. And I'll leave this as is for now. And then eventually, you know, it'll even out. But I'm really excited that even though I've been working on it for a while, I finally did work out my four central squares to build from. And I just like that idea. I like the way Kay's look, where it's going out in all four directions. So I have been pretty random with the placement for these. If I have a sock set or something, I'll put yarns that came together, I'll put those next to each other in the blanket. But otherwise, I just grab a mini out of my basket. But I did kind of plan these to all coordinate with this original square, and I like it. So this first square is from Adelaide Cottage. She's not dyeing anymore. But this was my first hand-dyed skein of yarn ever. A sweet lady at church handed me some money one day. We were in the trenches with our foster care work. We had six small children. Life was very, very busy, and we were in survival mode for a while. I don't really remember how much of our story I have shared, but three of our children we adopted through foster care, and so we went from three to six children overnight right before Christmas 8 years ago. And this sweet lady that we worship with just handed me some cash and said, you need to do something for you. So here, do something for you with this. And I spent part of it to buy myself my first ever hand-dyed skein of yarn. And I have never looked back. So that one's really special to me. And this is also in Anne of Green Gables colorway. It is called Cordelia. I just love it. And so that was my first square when I decided to make a memory blanket. And I love that now it's kind of gonna be right there in the center. This one is from Artistic Lily, and she is also not dyeing yarn anymore. I think this was called Floral, and it is one of my favorite colorways that I have ever made socks with. And it's one of my favorite pairs of socks, and it's one of the ones I wear the most, and I just love it. This one is that roller rink colorway that I just showed you a few minutes ago in that cowl, dyed by Paper Crane Yarns. And this one is Woodland Shenanigans from Legacy Fiber Arts. I bought one of their micro sock sets a couple of years ago, and that's my leftovers from that. So anyway, this is not getting a ton of attention because I'm really focusing on that scarf right now, but it sits in our living room, and it is the perfect thing to pull out when I'm reading in the evenings with the children, with the family. I also, can you even with this basket? I am just rambly today. This is going to be a long episode. So sorry, but I'm going to keep talking. I was antiquing with my daughter last week, and we came across a booth that had a lot of baskets, and I love baskets. So of course I stopped to look, and all of them were very reasonably priced. Some of them were in not great shape, but a lot of them were in really good shape. All of them were very reasonably priced, but this one didn't have a price tag. And of course it was my favorite because that's how it always goes. And some, you know, some antique stores won't sell you something, or thrift stores, that kind of place. They won't sell something to you if it doesn't have a price tag on it. And so I was afraid that was going to be what happened. But I noticed that the basket right next to it had two price tags with two different prices. And so I took it up to the front and I said, here's the situation. I really want this basket, but I don't know how much it costs. But that one next to it has two different prices on it. So can we work something out? And she said, yeah, I think it makes sense for this one to be the cheaper one. And I was like, well, okay. So I got this for $7 and I am in love with it. And it's just perfect for this. You know, the blanket itself isn't very big yet, but I've got a lot of scraps up to like here. So the blanket just lays on top. But it is a really nice, sturdy, handmade basket. It's got just a beautiful, you know, the bottom of it is in really good shape. It's my favorite find so far this year. Maybe my only one, but anyway. I was so excited about that, and I knew immediately that it was going to be the thing to hold my memory blanket. And it was kind of perfect timing because the basket I had it in, it was kind of outgrowing, so it was perfect. I think that's really it for right now. That's what I'm working on at the moment. I will go ahead and show you one planned project. Excuse me. This is a thing I've enjoyed doing lately. I've been planning out my projects. You know, I'm always planning gifts. But I'm also really trying this year to work from stash instead of buying so much yarn. You know, I joke with friends that, and I think I have said this on the podcast before, that buying yarn and knitting yarn are really two different hobbies. And, you know, we call it our collection and all of that. And I really enjoy having a stash to work from. But, you know, just to save some money and also to use the beautiful things that I have fallen in love with and purchased in the past, I'm really going to focus on knitting things from my stash this year. So I've really enjoyed planning out my projects using what I have. And when I'm doing that, I like to go ahead and get the next one ready. And so I have yarn and needles and everything in a bag so that when I'm at the right moment, when I'm in the right mood, in the right mindset, I can just grab that bag and I don't have to do all that gathering. I am such a process knitter that the knitting is the thing I want to do. You know, I don't want to have to worry. Swatching doesn't really bother me so much anymore, but I want to be able to just sit down and knit and not spend all of my time on the organizing and the gathering and the putting away. So all that stuff I have to do because it's part of the hobby, but it's not the fun part. So anyway, when I'm in the mood to do the gathering, I do, and then I just set the bag aside until I'm ready to start working on it. So I have this really cute bag from Daisy Girl and Company. And actually, this was part of a collaboration with Artistic Lily, who I just mentioned a minute ago. She had a beautiful floral inspired sock set that was the greens and pinks from this fabric. It was so nice. So I've had this for a couple of years. And again, the bright colors are not what usually draws me, but I'm just enjoying having this sitting in my basket, looking at it. But I'm planning on knitting a very simple eyelet shawl with this yarn from Candy Shop Yarns. This is the full skein from the advent calendar from 2023. This is called Malibu Beach. And I showed it last time in the skein, but it's got just a little bit of all of the colors in this one skein, all the colors from the advent calendar. And I just think it's amazing that people can do that. I'm afraid it's getting washed out. It's really hard for me because of the window behind the camera. It's hard for me to see what it's really going to look like on the screen. So I keep holding it up here, and I don't know if you're really getting a real good view of it, but it's hard to capture in it with the camera, but it is so pretty. So I've got my needles in here and stitch markers and the yarn, and in a few days when I'm going to try to get more progress on that scarf first, but in a few days I'll cast this on. So I'm excited about that, and it'll be fun. Like I've knit just the bare, like, little tiniest corner to finish up my habitation throw, and I've knit the last few rows of the cowl with this yarn, but I'm excited to watch it knit up into a bigger project. So that will be my next cast on, maybe this weekend, sometime soon. So I think that is all of the knitting for this time. So I guess I'll go into some things that I'm enjoying. And this is just something that I picked up recently that I have to show you because I love it. This is, I think they call it a dumpling pouch. I've seen somebody call it a dumpling pouch. But this is a felt notions pouch that I picked up from Never Not Knitting. Never Not Knitting, Alana, was the first podcaster I ever knew about. First knitting podcast I ever listened to. I was so sad when she stopped recording. But I have several things that I've ordered from her shop over the years. And I just love her attention to detail, her aesthetic, her patterns. She's designed some amazing patterns. So anyway, I just love her. I love her shop. And I love this pouch. It is so cute. It's actually very functional, but it's so cute. So it's just it's a felt pouch with a metal zipper that goes like, it's a big, long zipper, so it allows the pouch to open really wide. It has a flat bottom, so it sits really nicely on the table next to me. And one of the things I love about it is that it has these pockets. Yesterday, I don't know if I said this earlier today, but I tried, like, for an hour, I worked on recording this podcast yesterday, and nothing went right. Nothing went smoothly. My mouth and my brain, like, disconnected. So many things going on. Like, our neighbors were shooting targets, and so the dogs were losing their minds, and the kids were in and out, and it was insane. So I scrapped that and did this today, which is at least a little better. But when I was trying to show this yesterday, things were falling out because I was trying to show these pockets. But it has has these pockets. Like, this is specifically for a tape measure. And then on the other side, it has a little pocket for scissors and a place to hang a stitch marker ring. When you buy stitch markers from Never Not Knitting, they come in sets on these rings. This, I don't know how well you can see that, but this is umbrellas and raindrops that I got from her several months ago. But then there's still room in the bottom for whatever else you want. And you can see there's a lot of space left. I usually keep a cocoa knit row counter in here. I've got a cable needle, just whatever you might need. It is one of the cutest, most functional, actually truly helpful things I have purchased in a long time. I love it. So you can get it filled with a matching tape measure and the tiny little bonsai scissors. and some stitch markers. You can buy it with all those things or by itself. And I had already had the tiny scissors. I have multiple tape measures, so I just got the empty one, but it is so cute. And I really, really like it. A couple of other things I've been enjoying that are new to me. This is a new copy of a not new book. I've already mentioned that I love Little Women. I'm sure if you've been around very long, you're not surprised by that, and you've probably heard me say it. It is just one of my very, very favorites. And I saw this new edition a few weeks ago, and I thought, well, I mean, I don't need another copy. I have one. But then I decided that I did need it. I had a gift card from my in-laws, and so I used part of it on this, and I'm pretty excited about it. It is just lovely. I don't know if you can see it, but there's some subtle texturing on the cover, and of course the gold foil on the cover that you can see. Gilt edge pages. It's got a pretty ribbon marker that matches the color of the cover. Nice quality paper. It's just so nice. And I love books, and I love finding a well done copy of an old beloved book. And I don't know, I just love this. So my girls have decided that pretty soon they want to read Little Women for our book club. We read it together several years ago, when we were still doing nap time, like I mentioned, when we were in survival mode with a bunch of little kids. Nap time was chaotic. Everything was chaotic. And as a way to bond with the children in smaller groups, because one-on-one is very hard when you have a large family, we had a girls' room and a boys' room. And so on a couple of days a week, I would go and sit with the girls in their room and read to them during, like, before they took their naps. And on the alternate days, I would do the same. I'd read a different book to the boys during their quiet time before they had to go to sleep. And Little Women was what I started with the girls when they were small. And so we all have very fond memories of that, but you know, that's also been 7 years, and they've grown a lot, and their experiences are different, and their perspectives are different. And so I'm really excited that that's the one they want to do for our book club. We're finishing up our current novel. This next Wednesday will be our kind of grand finale for that book. And then we have a shorter book that we're going to do that will only take us a week or two. And so we're going to do that one first. And then in a month or so, move into Little Women. And I'm really excited about that. And so that was kind of the catalyst to going ahead and buying another copy, because one of my daughters doesn't have her own copy yet. And I was like, I can help you with that. Out of the kindness of my heart. So anyway, I picked that up at my local bookstore yesterday. And I'm really excited about it. I just think it's so pretty. I love, you know, I like pretty things. It's nice to have pretty things around me. And especially when it's one that I know I will use and enjoy. One more thing I wanted to share is this journal that I have been looking for just the right thing for a while. And this actually was delivered right before I started podcasting. So it is still empty. But look how soft and floppy the leather is. You never know when you're ordering things online. I just hope for the best. Like, read all the reviews, look at all the pictures, and hope for the best. But it's just a very simple ruled journal with this gorgeous leather cover. So my plan for this is to create a commonplace book. I don't know if you're familiar with that concept, but it's a Charlotte Mason concept, but it doesn't really originate with her. It is a practice that goes back even further than that. But just a place to keep, you know, your favorite thoughts, your favorite quotes, scriptures. I'm always drawn to old hymns, the very poetic lyrics of old hymns. And as a teenager, I had a journal that I would kind of collect all those things, quotes from books and scriptures and thoughts that I had just to keep it in one place. And I have really fallen away from that practice, but I stumbled across one of those journals a couple of weeks ago as I was kind of reorganizing some things. And oh, as you do, I sat down and just started reading it, and I thought, why don't I do this anymore? So I wanted one. I specifically looked for one that wasn't a refillable journal because I wanted it to be a book on its own, not just like a notebook stuck inside a pretty cover. I wanted it to be its own book. And I have notes on my phone. I have scribbled down things in other notebooks. And so I've got all these quotes that I love to refer back to, but I don't have a good way to refer back to them. And so that's one of the things I want to do this afternoon, is start moving those into this beautiful journal. I'm really excited about that. And I'm also, I'm wanting to incorporate that into our homeschool. My kids are mostly teenagers at this point. Five of them are, and the sixth one will be later this year. It's hard to believe. So I'm hoping to incorporate this idea into our homeschool. And not only is it great penmanship practice, which is a thing I'm always trying to fit in, but I think it's just a good thing to have. And to help them read, kind of on the lookout for those gems, you know. I fall in love with a book that has those poetic or clever turns of phrase. There are some books, some authors that I love, like Truman Capote. His novels are very strange. They're not usually my favorite books. But that man could put a phrase together like nobody else. And I really value that. And so I'll read his books and maybe not enjoy the whole thing, maybe not love the storyline, but there are so many little phrases that I can pull out that I just love. The first book I read by him was The Grass Harp. And that one is all underlined and marked up. And so many of my books, I read with a pencil and I'll underline the quote that I love. And I'll even write the page number in the front cover so I can find it. So many of my books have that kind of system, but I really want something where I can put all of those things in one place so I can easily find what I'm looking for, or just have a nice collection of those thoughts and words that kind of thrill my creative soul, you know? So I'm really excited to get started with that. I was not expecting this to be delivered until Monday, so it was really exciting to have it delivered today. And that's one of the things I will be working on this weekend. I'm excited about that. I think that is all. I probably should wrap this up because I'm probably running out of luck. The dogs have been relatively quiet. I can see my son running through the pasture out the window, so hoping his schoolwork is done. I am so glad that you are here. I'm glad that you've chosen to spend some of your time with me today. I always hope that making that choice will in some way bless you or help you just to have a few moments of peace and calm. And I love hearing from you. I'm just so thankful for the support all of you have given me to keep doing this podcast, and the circle of friends that I have met through this has been so exciting and so much fun. So I hope you are well. I hope you have a wonderful weekend. I hope that you are staying warm wherever you are. It has been very cold here, but we are blessed with some sunshine today, which is very, very nice. I will, I guess I will try to record again in 2 weeks. Probably won't try to stick to my previous schedule, which would be having me record a week from today. I'll probably be back in 2 weeks, and I look forward to talking to you then. Have a great day. Hello again. I was just going through watching my video to get ready for editing, and I remembered something that I wanted to share with you. I've already put away the tripod and everything, so I'm going to talk fast so I don't break my arm. Holding it out here in front of me. Anyway, I am really excited because one of my pictures from our trip to Alaska last September was chosen as a finalist to be featured in the Alaska Railroad's 2025 calendar. Photos posted on social media with you featuring something about the train or the railroad and tagged with their specific hashtag are all entered, and 12 finalists are selected, and then there is voting to determine which one of those wins the grand prize, which includes cash and railroad tickets and the cover photo for the calendar. So one of my photos will be in the calendar for sure and is up for the grand prize. Voting is happening from, I think, yesterday to January 23rd. And I mean, yeah, it would be really cool to win the grand prize, but honestly, I'm just so excited that one of my pictures was chosen to be included in that calendar. How cool is that? So anyway, the voting is happening on Facebook, and you can go and please at least go look at all those gorgeous photos. Vote for mine if you see fit. Don't if you don't. But I just wanted to share because I'm so excited. So I can't wait next year to use that calendar and that railroad, the travel we did in Alaska, the days we spent on those trains were some of the coolest experiences of my life. And so it's just an extra cherry on top that now one of my pictures will be in their calendar next year. So that's all. I just wanted to share.